Hi everyone, a very good evening to all of you, and let us quickly start discussing how are we going to score 90 plus in our biology paper which is coming up on this 14th of March, right? So in biology, one good thing is there that the pattern of the paper hasn't changed much as it has in case of chemistry and physics, right? So I will be discussing the exam pattern. I will be discussing the important topics, the important diagrams, and I will be discussing what changes are there in the format of biology paper compared to last year, right? So let us start, right? Okay, welcome everyone. First and foremost, I think the weightage remains same. Absolutely no change in the weightage of various units, and it is same as per the last year, right? So last year also we had reproduction for almost 14 marks, genetics and evolution, the largest topic almost for 18 marks, biology in human welfare, which requires more of remembering stuff. It is again for 14 marks, biotechnology, another 10 marks, ecology, another 14 marks, and this completely makes up my 70 marks of theory paper, right? So, okay, all right. I think you need to tune in your volume a little bit more. I think I am pretty much audible to all of you, right? Okay, so that is the weightage of my biology paper, which is going to come up on this 14th of March, right? And I think we all know it is for 3 hours. Total marks are 70. So that is something which is very clear to us, right? So let's move forward. About genetics, Syed, what do you want me to know? What do you want me to tell you about genetics? So we'll be discussing unit-wise important topics. First and foremost, reproduction in organism will not have a huge weightage, right? But this is a basic and a fundamental chapter. In fact, most of the questions are likely to come from sexual reproduction in flowering plants, sexual reproduction in human beings, and reproductive health, right? Remember, gametogenesis, your megasporogenesis, microsporogenesis, structure of your ovule, right? So all those things are important. Your double fertilization, triple fusion, post-fertilization events, types of pollination. So all these things are very important, right? So please do remember all these things. MCQs, Harsh, we will be discussing each and everything bit by bit, right? So first, let me take up the important topics first. All right. Hi, Surbhi. Okay. So let's keep moving. And in human reproduction, I think you know very well, there is a huge possibility of a male reproductive system diagram coming up, right? A female reproductive system diagram may come up. The menstrual cycle flow, that diagram might come up. So these are certain, one of these diagrams is surely going to come up in your 5 marks question, right? So there is always a question for that. Is there a direct link? Yes, yes, you can definitely enter through the Meritnation website. Okay. So I think male and female reproductive system diagrams are very important. Gametogenesis, spermatogenesis, your oogenesis, right? And the process of oogenesis, the second meiotic division is completed only at the time of fertilization. So do remember that. So there are questions related to it. Fertilization, embryo development, blastocyst formation, implantation, pregnancy, placenta. So very frequently questions do come on placenta. Questions do come on parturition process, lactation. So these are very important things, right? And coming down to reproductive health, STDs, a major topic. Your various ARTs are very important. Your ZIFT, IVF, GIFT. So all these things we must be aware about. Yes. All right. I hope till here I am absolutely clear to everyone, right? So let's move forward from here and let us talk about what is going to come up in genetics and evolution. Well, coming down to the first chapter, we can definitely talk about Mendelian genetics, your monohybrid cross, your dihybrid cross are very important. Blood groups, that is ABO type of blood typing, that is important. What is pleiotropy, polygenic inheritance? Your chromosomal theory of inheritance is very important, right? What are chromosomes, genes, And then sex determination in humans, birds, honeybees, all right, Akanksha. Well, it's a general cough. Then we will have topics like hemophilia, color blindness. So all the various Mendelian disorders are very important, which are listed down there in your book, right? Your Down syndrome, Turner syndrome, your trisomy, your 21st chromosome. You must be remembering what it is. Your pedigree chart analysis. That is very important. One question might come up from there also. Yes, sorry. The list will be provided to you. You can enter through go to the link, right? Enter your details in the Meritnation website and top 100 questions will be provided to you. All right, let's move ahead and let's talk about the next important topics from the next chapter, molecular basis of inheritance. Well, this is a very important chapter, right? It consists of your central dogma, very important point. Your various experiments, right, from Sir Frederick Griffith, Hershey's and Chase, right, Meselson and Stock. So all those experiments are important. Then what is your transcription, genetic code, translation, gene expression and regulation, especially lac operon, which is there in our book. Then we have to talk about Human Genome Project. What is RISE Genome Project? Well, very little information regarding that is given in your NCERT, but this listing of topics is there on your CBSE website, right? So I have picked up the listing from there. So you need to learn a little bit about RISE Genome Project too. Sarita, this class is basically catering to your biology paper, CBSE paper, which is going to come up on this 14th, right? So we are discussing that over here. All right. So let us talk about DNA fingerprinting. That is another important topic. Coming down to evolution. Well, Darwinian evolution is very important. Hardy-Weinberg law is very important. Convergence, divergence, right? Adaptive radiation. So all these are very important concepts. I think you all must be absolutely clear with all of these things, right? Yes, Shruti, same here. Welcome to the class. All right. So after this, the next unit, biology in human welfare, right? It is written as and, so we can turn it into in. So the first chapter is human health and diseases, and there are various diseases discussed like ringworm, amebiosis, common cold, pneumonia, typhoid, malaria, dengue, chikungunya, filariasis, ascariasis. All this listing is as per your CBSE website. So we need to have our concepts very clear regarding all of this. Right, Akanksha? So no need to be worried about it. Then, what are the basic concepts of immunology? What is the fundamental principle regarding vaccinations, cancer, HIV, AIDS, adolescence, drugs and alcohol abuse? Generally comes as a 3-marker, right? So still read it a bit. Yes, I know this is a little bit of a difficult thing, right? Basu, please go back and watch the recordings of Meritnation classes. And I think the concept of translation will be absolutely clear to you. You know, it is the conversion of the mRNA code into the polypeptide chain, right? So that is translation in short. Shruti, let us discuss what are the important things which are coming up. Then we'll come down to the little bit of questions, right? So strategies for enhancement in food production. Well, this chapter is primarily testing your retention skills. So you will have to remember a lot of things here, right? You have to talk about single cell protein. That is a very important thing. What is biofortification, apiculture, animal husbandry, plant breeding, tissue culture, all these topics are important. Harsh, you can get them via link that is mentioned over there in the description below, right? Fill in your details and you will get the top 100 questions. Okay, microbes in human welfare. I think this is a very useful topic and one of the most famous questions from here, one of the most commonly asked questions from here is your biogas plant, right? Or that is a very important topic. So management of household sewage. So sewage treatment plant, STPs, energy generation, microbes as biocontrol agents, biofertilizers, antibiotics, right? So all these are very important. Amino acetylation? No, not much. Not much. Ashwet, it's not my birthday. All right, let's move ahead. And let's talk about the next unit. That is biotechnology and its application. You know very well, the first chapter talks about the principle and processes. And here, remember, your blue and white screening method of colonies, insertional inactivation. These are very important topics, right? Your diagram of your famous plasmid. What are the various plasmid vectors? So that is very important. When it comes to application of biotechnology, BT crops is something very famous. Transgenic animals and plants, biosafety, biopiracy, patent, gene therapy, fine, GMO, genetically modified organism. This human inulin is very important. So all these are important topics. You need to be very thorough with everything. Remember, your 12th standard compared to your 11th standard is pretty much less. So we are lucky. All right. So let's move ahead and let us talk about our last unit, which is ecology and environment. So in ecology and environment, the first chapter talks about organisms and population. And over here, you will have your various type of population pyramids, right? You must be aware about the population attributes like growth rate, birth rate, death rate, age distribution pyramids, right? What is the difference between a habitat and a niche, right? Population and ecological adaptations. So various population interactions, including mutualism, competition, predation, parasitism. So all these things we should be very much thorough with, right? All right. So Akanksha, let's focus here, right? Because you are very unlikely to get any question on corona. So I'm suffering just with common cold and cough. Okay, let's talk about the next chapter, that is the ecosystem. So here, what are the various things or factors of the ecosystem, including productivity, energy flow, pyramid of number, pyramid of biomass, pyramid of energy, nutrient cycles, especially your nitrogen, carbon, phosphorus cycle, right? What is ecological succession? Your Zayar succession, your hydrarch succession, all those things you should be very much clear with. What is carbon fixation, pollination, seed dispersal, oxygen release? So all these things we should be aware about. Okay, let us talk about our next chapter, that is biodiversity and its conservation. I think the last unit is the simplest of all, right? That will not take a lot of your effort. Alright, so it will talk about biodiversity, concepts, various patterns, importance of biodiversity, what are the various services provided to us by biodiversity, why do we need to conserve it, what is biodiversity hotspots, right, endangered organisms, extinction, red data book, biosphere reserves, national parks, sanctuaries, and Ramsar sites. So all these things are important, right? Easiest is genetics. Oh my God. Okay, then environmental issues, I think, is one of the easiest chapters. And some of the major things which often come from here is your ozone depletion, your global warming, right? So these are some of the most important things. Then another thing that can come up is deforestation, right? Or climate change. So all these are important things which can come up from this chapter, right? I hope this is all very easy, very simple. So I have just listed down all the important topics from all the 16 chapters that will be covered up in our syllabus, right? So I think now we can move on. No Akanksha, no assertion and reasoning question will be there. So rest assured, no assertion and reasoning question will be there. Well, Sri Lakshmi, the best bet is you start practicing the sample paper in your home itself, right? Do a little bit of time management. Don't write over the word limits. Wherever possible, draw neat and clean diagrams, right? That will fetch you more marks. Always underline the keywords, right? So these are certain tips which will definitely increase your marks. No assertion and reasoning, right? All right, let's move ahead and let us see. Okay, so coming down to our question paper pattern. Well, very short answer type questions will be 5 in number. just like the last year. So no change as of such. Total 5 marks. Section B, short answer type question. Each question carries 2 marks. There will be 7 such questions, total 14 marks. Again, not much change over there, right? The only change that I can see over here in your biology paper pattern is this. A new section D, which has come up over here, right? And this new section D is actually, every question over here will be of 3 marks. It will not be of 4 marks, right? And there will be 3 such questions, and in total, it will fetch you 9 marks. So this is something new. Otherwise, 1 mark questions, 2 marks questions, 3 marks questions, long answer, 5 marks questions are all same, right? So this is the only point of difference which is coming in this year, right? Otherwise, the rest of the paper is absolutely same. So this is something that we will be talking about. I will be discussing a sample paper, right? Where I will be focusing exclusively on this section D. All right. So let's move ahead. I hope this question paper pattern is clear to all of us, right? So the only thing which is new in biology is section D. For the rest of the paper, the pattern remains same as per the last year, right? So let's move ahead and let's talk about HIV and AIDS cycle with important diagram. Well, HIV cycle may not come as a diagram. Now I am discussing a sample paper. Let's look. In total, same number of questions as last year, 27 questions, right? Section A, just like the last year, 5 questions, each question carrying 1 mark. Section B, just like the previous years, again, 7 questions, each question of 2 mark. Section C, just like last year, right? So we have good number of questions and each question is carrying 3 marks. Section D is something new over here, which contains 3 questions. And each question consists of 3 marks, right? So this is something new. Section E is old, section D. So nothing as a change over there, right? And you know very well, you have to attempt all 27 questions. Only internal choices will be there. No external choices. Mohabbat, there is no need to be scared, right? The paper, biology paper is generally simple and sometimes a little lengthy. That is it, right? I think you all can do pretty well if you start practicing your sample papers. So I have just taken a snapshot of one of your sample papers. And I think we all can see that it is a very regular sample paper that we are used to looking at, right? So no change as of section A is concerned. It is all very simple, very normal. So this is a sample paper that I have taken a snapshot from your CBSE website only. So it looks pretty simple, nothing much ambiguous over there. Very ordinary paper. So we all can go through it. And then, yes, definitely you can score 90 plus. So this is your question number 5, most important cause of biodiversity. So remember, these are your first 5 MCQs. Most important cause of biodiversity loss is transcription is pretty much important, right? We all know that. So it is an important diagram also. Mohabbat, well, this session is limited to the discussion of your NCRT only, right? For your boards only. We are not discussing about your NEET, right? So let's restrict ourselves over there. Let us talk about section B. You can again see only internal choice is there. No external choice. right? And that too in some questions, not in all questions. Name any two copper related IUDs. Well, IUDs are a very common question. Remember that. They are a kind of contraceptive devices, right? And what is the full form of IUD? I think everyone knows it. Sporulation is important in when I talk about our reproduction in flowering plants. Yes, yes, Deepthi, you can draw your diagrams with pencil. Better if you use pencils of different colors, right? Or even sketch pens. Yes, copper T and Cu7 are the most famous one, right? Why is it not possible to study the inheritance pattern of traits in human beings the same way as it is done in pea plant? Because obviously you cannot mate and see the humans at random as you can do with the pea plants, right? Also, the number of progeny given birth is pretty limited, right? And what is the alternate method that we can use in case of humans? Yes, pedigree analysis. Absolutely correct, Mohammed Saleem. Yes, yes, yes. No, 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 Sriram. It is pedigree analysis. Absolutely correct. Well, Deepthi, just go by the guidelines. If they say that pencil is prohibited, don't use it, right? Use your sketch pens, which will not spill the color onto the back of your another page. Okay, so this is your section B. We can see all the various questions over here, right? I will not go into the details of section B. Well, here, let us talk about this figure. Which is ribose and which is deoxyribose? Which among the two is ribose and which among the two pentose sugar is deoxyribose? Yes, A is ribose. Absolutely correct. Yes, A is ribose. And the figure 2 talks about 2 deoxyribose. To be more precise, right? Yes, 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 yes. I think that is something very clear to us, right? And you can see now the well-labeled diagrams are coming of pistil showing the passage of growing of pollen tube up to its destination. So this can come up as a diagram and see it is carrying a huge weightage of 3 marks. Yes, yes, Goku, you are absolutely right. So that is something very important, right? So coming down to section C, each question is carrying 3 marks. And again, you can see, I think, are they mentioning a palindromic sequence or what? So anyways, we'll look into it. So how does gain or loss of chromosomes takes place in humans? I think this is something very simple if you pay a little attention, right? Describe one example each of chromosomal disorder along with the symptoms involved involving an autosome and a sex chromosome. So trisomy of the 21st chromosome is a typical example of separation of the chromosomes, right? During meiosis in the gametes. All right. So, or otherwise you can attempt this one. How many amino acids will be translated in each of the above two cases? That is what we need to find out. What is apomixis? A very usual question, right? And this sample paper seems to be a little bit slightly on a tougher note. So please prepare accordingly. So apomixis is a form of asexual reproduction that mimics sexual reproduction in plants. Explain with the help of a suitable example. So I think we all know what is apomixis, right? Yes, yes, Sandipta, that was aniploidy, right? The phenomena is aniploidy. All right, then this is a typical diagram which often comes, right? This is the Urey-Miller setup for abiogenesis theory of biological evolution, right? Okay. So then I can talk about, this is all about your section C, and the important section that I want to discuss with all of you is section D, right? So I will directly jump onto the section D and we'll discuss that and then we'll move forward, right? Well, Risha, both are equally important. The whole chapter is absolutely essential. Yes, 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 Salim. This is one of the important diagrams. Urian-Miller experiment. All right. Okay, so this is still we are discussing your section C. Right, let me come down to your section D. Now, this is something new, absolutely new. Now, let us see over here. There are three questions, each of 3 marks, and each question is split into 3 parts, and each part is carrying 1 mark. So that means in itself, the question is very easy. You need not write stories over here, right? So let us look at the first question. So question number 22. And over here, let us look at the first statement that is written over here. So with reference to the above schematic diagram of spermatogenesis and oogenesis, answer the following questions. About 300 million spermatozoa may be present in a human male ejaculation at one time. Calculate how many spermatocytes will be involved to produce this number of spermatozoa. Rajesh, I am discussing question number 22 only right now, right? Yes, 300 million by 4. That turns out to be 75 million. Absolutely correct. So remember, 75 million primary spermatocytes will undergo meiosis to form 300 million spermatozoa, right? How many spermatids will be formed? How many spermatids will be formed? Navneet, no, Akansha is absolutely right. Remember, spermatids are round and they simply undergo spermiogenesis. Right? The process which converts the spermatids into the actual motile spermatozoa. So they will be 300 million. Absolutely right. How many chromatids are found during oogenesis in primary oocyte? Well, recall, what is the primary oocyte? How many chromatids are found during oogenesis in primary oocyte? Anyone? Muskan, come on. AK. So we are talking about humans. All right. So number of chromosomes will be 46 in primary oocyte. Any idea? Is primary oocyte undergoing meiosis or is it arrested in some stage of meiosis? Can you recall it? In which stage of meiosis is the primary oocyte stuck? Lakhan, both are important. Yes, it is arrested in prophase 1. Absolutely correct. So meiosis 1 is not complete. Absolutely correct. So therefore, it has 46 chromosomes inside it, right? What about the first polar body? How many chromosomes will it have? Yes, that is arrested in diplotene. Absolutely correct. Mohabbat. Yes, Mohabbat. Absolutely correct. Yes. Your first polar body will have, again, 23 chromosomes. Remember, first polar body is produced as a result of first meiotic division, completion of first meiotic division, right? In the graafian follicle. So it will contain 23 chromosomes. And your secondary oocyte will contain another 23 chromosomes. I hope this is clear to everyone. So this is a simple question. You see, the replies are not very lengthy, but it requires a little bit of understanding and computation. So these are the kinds of questions which are likely to come up. So section D is absolutely new over here. Well, Mohabbat, your NCRT and your sample papers, your NCRT exemplar. Alifia, I think I have already talked about that, right? In that, your BT cotton, transgenic crops, right? GMO, human insulin, those are very important topics. All right, let us talk about large quantities. Next question. Large quantities of sewage is generated every day in cities and towns, which is treated in STPs to make it less polluting. Given below is a flow diagram of one of the stages of STPs. Observe the given flow diagram and answer the questions accordingly. Okay, let's look at the flow diagram. So this is the flow diagram. Primary effluent is passed into large aeration tanks. Effluent pass into settling tanks to form the sediment. Why primary effluent is passed into large aeration tanks? Well, don't be nervous about it. Yes, Goku, NCRT is lengthy, right? Yes, yes, Salim, absolutely correct. Yes, that is to reduce the BOD, right? And what will happen? What does it indicate? Reduction in BOD. It indicates the degradation of organic pollutants, right? So the organic pollutants which were there in the water have been degraded, and that's why your BOD has come down drastically, right? So that is for this reason. So what is the scientific term used for the sediments formed in the second case? When the primary effluent is shifted for secondary treatment, we do get some sediments. What is the scientific term for that? It is not flux, Akansha. Not flux. Yes. Yes. Adi, absolutely correct. So it is a secondary sludge. Activated secondary sludge. Right? What is the significance? It is again used as an inoculum for secondary treatment, a part of it. And the rest of it undergoes anaerobic digestion by anaerobic bacteria for the production of biogas. Right? Yes, that is the answer. So very simple question. And remember, this is a very standard topic. STPs are very likely to come up. Yes. Explain the final steps resulting in the formation of biogas in a large tank before the treated effluent is released into water bodies. I think I have already talked about it, right? Your secondary sludge will be pushed into an anaerobic digester tank where anaerobic bacteria will act on it, and it will lead to the release of biogas. Yes, Mohamed. Yes, it is. All right. Let's look into the next question, the final question of section D. So this is something new for us. So they are showing a figure of catalytic converter, right? So name any two metals that are used in the catalytic converter. What are the two metals which are most commonly used in the catalytic converter? Guys, come on. Let's make it quick. What are the two metals which are most commonly used in a catalytic converter? Yes, platinum, rhodium, not cadmium, platinum, rhodium, palladium. Absolutely correct. Yes. Name the gases released after passing the exhaust hydrocarbon through the catalytic converters. So this is again very simple. Second, part B. Come on, Uchit. Yes, Akansha, CO2 and? Look at the second question, Bhanu. CO2 and H2O. Because what you are passing through the catalytic converter are hydrocarbons. So please read the question carefully. Focus on every word. Okay. Which other poisonous gas is missing in the exhaust pollutants of an automobile in the above diagram? Which gas is missing? Any idea? Yes, NO2 or oxides of nitrogen. Absolutely correct. And they will come out from the other end as nitrogen gas. Carbon monoxide is already there, the rain. Not NH2. No. Nitric oxide or oxides of nitrogen. Right. So this is your typical section D. Right. And then our normal 5 marks questions. Right. That is section E. So I think we all can see it is very simple, very easy, right? So name a free-living non-pathogenic nematode whose DNA has been sequenced. Can any one of you name it? Well, Navneet, it is very easy, right? Just pick up the basic concepts, your diagrams, right? Your ecological pyramids, your nutrient cycles, productivity, characteristics of population, that is all very easy. Yes, yes, Uchit, absolutely right. Right. That's the answer. I think someone just Googled it. All right, let's move on to the next one. Okay, so what is mutation breeding? Give an example of a crop and disease to which resistance was induced by mutation. I think this is also very easy, right? You have already learned it in biology and human welfare, right? Differentiate between pisciculture and aquaculture. See, such kind of interesting questions might come up. See, sheep is not the answer over there. Yes. Yes, Adi, absolutely correct. All right. So, if a patient is advised antiretroviral drug, which infection is he suffering from? How do vaccines prevent subsequent microbial infections? How a cancerous cell differs from a normal cell? So, see, all intelligent questions are coming up, right? HIV AIDS, absolutely correct. Many microbial pathogens enter the gut of human along with food. Name the physiological barrier that protects the body from such pathogens. Yes, Dhiren, NCRT is a must. All right. So, these are my 5 markers, right? So please go through the sample paper. Gastric juice is the answer. Absolutely correct. Acid in the stomach. All right. So these are my 5 markers and I will now come down to some important diagrams. I think structure of ovule and anther is something that I have already talked about. Human male and reproductive system is another one. Structure of a sperm, events of menstrual cycle, structure of DNA, mRNA, transcription unit is very important. tRNA, nucleosome, population growth curves, age pyramids, nutrient cycles. These are all very important diagrams. So I will just pick up few of them for you. So this is the LS of a complete flower, right? Very simple. So this is my female gametophyte. I hope everyone can recall it. Your embryo sac. And this is what? This is a TS of your young anther. Right? And we can see the enlarged view of one microsporangium showing various layers. The innermost layer of tapetum cells which nourishes your microspores. Yes. And then we can also see another diagram, the diagram of a sperm. And here the acrosome is very important, right? Goku, you need to learn it completely, right? And then, of course, the schematic representation of spermatogenesis and oogenesis in humans. And remember, the oogenesis in humans is completed only at the time of fertilization. The secondary oocyte finally becomes the ovum at the time of fertilization only. Right? And then this is a diagram of a nucleosome. Very simple. Right? You can talk about the histone octamer. So what all is there in the histone octamer? I think everyone knows it. What are the 4 histone proteins? 2H2A, 2H2B, 2H3, 2H4, right? And then the H1 histone actually clips the whole nucleosome together. All right, finally, your Urian-Miller experiment. I think, Lakhan, we have already talked about it a lot of time, right? Commonly, it is H3 and H4. It is not H5, right? Oh my God, what happened, Adi? Okay, another important diagram. The structure of an antibody. Remember, two heavy chains, which are again attached with each other by disulfide linkages of cysteine, right? And it is attached to two light chains. And only this region is the variable region. Rest of the region is a constant region. Remember that. So these are important diagrams. Oh, the most important one. The E. coli cloning vector PBR332. Right? Showing the various restriction sites. There are many more restriction sites. We are not going into the details of it. Right? Just show the ampicillin resistance area, tetracycline resistance area. Ori region is very important. Right? And some of the major restriction sites. Ayush, you can find that down there in the link. Right? Fill in your details and you will get the top 100 questions. Okay, Anu, what do you want me to explain in over here? Uh-oh, which diagram do you forget? It is very easy to recall. Just practice it 2 times, 3 times, and you will be able to remember it. Oh, the whole diagram you want me to explain. Well, this is the ampicillin resistant site. This is the tetracycline resistant site, right? They too have the restriction sites over here. And if any of this, so ampicillin resistant site is the place where a new insert comes in. Then your new bacteria with this recombinant plasmid will not be resistant to ampicillin, right? Due to insertional inactivation, but it will be resistant to tetracycline. So I hope you can understand these concepts. BAMH1 is again another restriction site here. These are all various restriction sites. Abhishek. Alright. The final diagram. Downstream processing. Bioreactor. Right. Your steer tank bioreactor. That is there. This is another diagram. And then we have some important tables. Tables of various varieties of crops. Right? And what are the various diseases that they are resistant to? And this is a very important and a fundamental diagram in population interaction. Right? If both the species are benefiting each other, we know it's a case of mutualism. If both of them are harming each other, they are competing with each other. If one is benefiting, one is being harmed, it can be a case of predation or a parasitism. In commensalism, one is benefited, the other is not harmed. In case of amensalism, one is harmed, the other is not benefited. Amensalism, okay, Kachrani Joseph, well, it is a case where one organism is harming another organism without deriving any benefit by harming another one, right? I hope this is clear. All right, let's move ahead and let's talk about the next thing, the most important tip. Definitely, you must read your NCERT book, practice various diagrams, solve previous year question papers, and definitely attempt your NCERT exemplar, right? So these are my final tips and all the best. And I hope all of you will be there with me again and all the best. Bye-bye, everyone. Take care.